בשיעור היום אנחנו שואלים למה ואיך מדעניות ומדענים מתקשרים עם הציבור הרחב. אבל שאלה לא פחות חשובה היא האם מדעניות ומדענים צריכים בכלל לתקשר עם הציבור הרחב? האם זו חובתם המקצועית? האם זו זכותם, רק אם מתחשק להם? מי שתעזור לנו להשיב על השאלה הזו היא פרופסור מאיה הורסט מהאוניברסיטה הטכנולוגית של דנמרק. וכדי שנוכל לשוחח, אני אעבור עכשיו לאנגלית. I'm delighted to have with us Professor Maja Horst, Professor of Responsible Technology at DTU Technical University of Denmark, who is also the President-elect of the European Association for the Study of Science and Technology. Maja, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Well, my first question is, should scientists share their research with wider audiences? Do scientists have individual or an institutional responsibility to engage with the public?
I think it's important that scientific institutions or collectives do actually have a responsibility. I don't think it should be put on the individual scientist. I think that's a little bit too much. And also, I think there's some people who really don't enjoy, you know, going out into the sort of big public and talking about their research. So in that sense, I don't think everybody should do it, but I do think that collectives ought to have this. And then I also think that rather than talking about it as a sort of obligation and responsibility, I would like to think that most scientists actually want to share their research with the public. And I think that it's important to think that there can be different ways of doing this, you know, that if you've done something that's very applied, you might want to share the knowledge so that it can come out and be of use. And, you know, like if you've invented a vaccine against coronavirus, then you really want to tell people about that and get it used, right? But maybe if you're an astronomer, you're not sort of producing knowledge that has to be translated into actual use in society as such, but it's still important. You can still want to sort of share knowledge in order to transform society or let us know more about who we are and where we come from. So I think that there's different motivations for people to share research, some more applied and maybe some is more about enlightenment.
I think that many scientists, when they think about science communication, they think about themselves telling other people stuff. So I know stuff and I want other people to also know it, so I'm going to tell them. Hopefully they'll listen. But I think when you're talking about science communication, you're talking about something else. You're also talking about listening to the public. You're talking about dialogue.
Yeah, I think it's important that scientists don't just sort of don't only think about what they want to tell people, but also try to take an interest in what's actually, what are people's interests? What do they want to know about? What are they curious about? And then sort of start from that and then feed into that discussion. Because I think in some ways you can say that science is basically a very structured way of working with curiosity. And I think it's a very human thing. I think we all share curiosity. So I think it's much easier for scientists if they, you know, start with what people want to know, what they're curious about, rather than sort of start with what I want to tell. You know, often when I want to tell people something, maybe my kids, you know, they don't want to listen. But if I start with what is interesting for them, I've got a much better chance of actually making them listen to what I'm saying. And then, of course, if we go to other areas that might be more sort of controversial or more important for sort of political decisions, etc., I think it's even more important that, you know, scientists listen to politicians, for instance. What is it? What is the kind of knowledge that they need? What are the sort of big issues about decisions that have to be made so that scientists can feed into that sort of being helpful to the process rather than just thinking that they should stand up on a box and just talk and everybody else should just listen to what they say.
I can imagine a few scientists I know that have this exact impression of science communication, but really that doesn't always work. I'm thinking about biotechnology, specifically about genetically modified food. I think that in Europe there were quite fierce discussions and debates about that. And on the one hand, there were members of the public and people who care deeply about the environment who felt that the scientists don't listen and they just do whatever they want. And on the other hand, there were molecular biologists who thought that people are uninformed and irrational. And I'm wondering, what can you do? What structures out there to make these debates more useful, more effective?
Yeah, so that's a really good example of something that's gone absolutely, completely wrong. And it's actually very hard to do something about it once it's become so controversial and so entrenched in different camps that don't really listen to each other at all. If you look at sort of the origin of the discussion, I think it's important to say that a lot of the sort of first opposition to genetically modified foods, it wasn't unreasonable. It was sort of relevant questions about who gains on this technology, who runs the risks, you know, why is it multinational companies earning a lot of money on making what was then sort of seen to be maybe risky releases into, you know, by having crops out in nature that could spread to other species. And of course, I mean, I wish we hadn't ended up here, but I think that what went wrong was that the proponents of the technology really didn't listen to the sort of critical questions. And that made the criticism more and more harsh. And then it sort of really went badly, and these sides can't really talk to each other also, because now it's about lots of other questions than just the technology. And this is why I think it's extremely important that when we discuss new technologies, new emerging technology that might be controversial, that we do it with more respect for different people's viewpoints and actually try to listen as much as we talk in order to kind of understand what are the worries, what are the concerns that people have. We have quite a good example in Denmark, because when embryonic stem cell research really came on the agenda around 2000, there was sort of the technologists wanted the legislation changed, because you were only allowed to do embryonic research, to do research on embryonic stem cell lines in order to improve the IVF technique, for that specific technique, and they wanted to have a wider mandate. So they needed the law to be changed for that. And politicians said, well, before we're going to change the law, we need to have a big sort of public discussion and debate about this. And people actually from both sides entered into kind of what I think was a quite a fruitful, mature debate about that. And the interesting thing is that it ended up that most people said, okay, we can see the point of this. We think it might be a good idea to change the legislation. Legislation was changed, and it has never been controversial since. And it's actually, Denmark is one of the countries where there's quite a high relatively support for this form of research. And I think that's a good example of, if you kind of take it up and you actually respectfully listen to different viewpoints, then you have a chance of sort of not ending up where we ended up in Europe with the genetically modified organisms. That's a huge catastrophe in a sense, because we need that technology probably in order to kind of mitigate against the consequences of climate change and lots of other things. But we don't really have that technology in the same way available as we could have if we hadn't ended up in this sort of really controversial place.
You talk a lot about listening respectfully to other views. And I think many scientists would say, how can I listen respectfully to other views if the person in front of me doesn't know what they're talking about? Maybe they can go and, you know, study a few years, maybe take my course, maybe read a textbook, and then we can talk.
Yeah, but it's just not working like that, is it? I mean, we live in democratic countries, and we say that everybody who's above a certain age has the right to vote. And we've decided that that's the best way we can govern our country, to create a collective that we all want to be in and be part of. And if that's the case, then we have to live with the fact that we don't all know the same amount of things. We have to learn from each other and listen. And of course, scientists shouldn't learn from sort of non-scientists about their own scientific area. I mean, obviously scientists know a lot more science than non-scientists. But for instance, if you're a researcher on a particular disease, you might actually learn from patients on what it's like to live with that disease. or if you are trying to design a new electricity system so that we can use renewable energy better than we do at the moment, where, for instance, in Denmark, we turn off the wind turbines when it's too blowy because we can't use the excess capacity. So if you're trying to develop a new energy system where we can deal with that better, you actually also need to know about how people live with energy, energy consumption. What do they want? What do they not want? Do they want batteries themselves? Do they want to be in charge? Or do they want an automated system? So you need to know about this. And then, I mean, if you, again, let's use astronomy as a sort of case of science that's really not particularly applicable, but just still about things that we know. I mean, astronomers can investigate the sky and, you know, the universe, but and when you ask them what we get from that, often they talk about how we learn about where we come from and what it's like to be humans. I mean, that's not something that scientists themselves want to decide. I mean, that's a conversation that we should have in society. So I think it's also about respecting that, you know, different roles and different types of people have different input to this conversation that we have to have in common, because to me, that is what a society is. It's a common conversation about how we want to live our shared life together, and also how we want to build society for the future so that it's as good as it can be for as many of us as possible and all the rest of the life forms on this earth. And I think that to have that conversation in the best possible way with the most possible perspectives, we need to have as many voices take part in that discussion as possible.
Wow, you just gave a really, you put science communication in a much greater context of democracy and society that I think it's really very meaningful for us. It's not just about us telling people about the magnificent and cool research we did. It's about building a society together. So my
But actually, I am quite concerned at the moment about societies breaking in two, in that half that kind of understands society, understands science and feel part of it and feel they can control it. And then possibly a large part of society that just feels left out and left behind and not, you know, included, not part of it. And those two parts of society might get worse and worse at talking to each other. I mean, we can see what happened in the US sort of in the last 5 years. And that's a really dangerous way to go for a society. It stops our ability to live together. I mean, I wouldn't want to live in a society like that.
So that leads me exactly to my last question. When I prepared for this conversation, I came across an interview you gave in which you said that you're really interested in knowing why some people believe that science is the solution to the society problems, while some people think that science is the cause of problems. Mm-hmm. And my question to you is why? Why really?
Why I'm interested in that? Well, that's because I think it's sort of basically, we live in a knowledge society. So scientific knowledge is one of the key resources of society that we have. We have to share that with as many as possible in order to have a stable society. And I think if you ask me, why do those people think that science doesn't have anything to do with them and they shouldn't trust it? I think that's to do with identity. I think that if you feel shut out of community, if you don't feel respected, if you don't feel that your problems are being taken seriously, you look for other forms of collectives, other forms of stories about who you are and what society is. And in all stories, we need heroes and villains. And I mean, the sort of scientific story tells one story about who's the hero and, you know, who's the villains. And of course, it's obvious if you feel shut out and not respected, you might actually take who the other people think is heroes and then make them into your villains. So I think that that's deep down to do with identity, a sense of belonging and a sense of respect. And if we share that with everybody, you know, it's easier to have a society that sticks together. So I think it's very fundamental things. And I think it's because science is so important to how we develop society at the moment. I think of course, then our identity constructions, the root of our sort of culture and feeling of togetherness and cohesion, that then also comes to be about science and who is included and who is not. So these are big questions. To me, this is sort of one of the most meaningful areas in you can sort of spend your time on. And I think it's incredibly important that more and more scientists take up this challenge of sort of supporting social cohesion and helping society hang together better.
Wow. I wish everybody listened to this last sentence and take it home. So thank you very much, Professor Maja Horst, Professor of Responsible Technology at DTU, Technological University of Denmark. Thank you.
Thank you.